Alhamdulillah, I will encourage that very much. And I don't like any interruption in the speech, but that interruption will be very good. All right. Interrupt writing checks. And also, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless the brother or the family that is going to match your contributions. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. I want to thank my dear brother Dr. Abdullah Ghazi and our dear sister Dr. Tasneema Ghazi for this very kind and gracious invitation. I remember that very vividly, that Dr. Ghazi mentioned that he is the first person whom I met as I landed in this beautiful nation, United States of America, at the Logan Airport in 1969. And Ghazis are the first people at his home. I had my first meal here in the United States. So I had to do Haqq Namak. That is, certainly they have done a wonderful job. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them. We spent many years together at the Center for the Study of World Religions as neighbors, and his children and my children grew together, and we have this fond and loving relationship, and I really admire him for the work that he has done. Both of them have done, Sister Tasneema and Brother Abdullah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them and bless them. I have known Iqra International Educational Foundation from its very inception in 1983. Its work and contribution to the Islamic education of Muslim children, both in the United States and abroad, are enormous. Many Islamic schools are indebted to Iqra, and many of our children have grown reading its Islamic books, as was mentioned by our dear brother Safazar Zuhr, and many others also mentioned that. Iqra has indeed produced a generation of Muslims now, and the second generation is on the way, and inshallah many more generations are going to benefit from its contribution, from its publications. On the other hand, also I would like to really express my great admiration for this city, the city of Chicago, which is really a mother city for the Muslims of America. Its vibrant community, that is you, my brothers and sisters, its many institutions and many leaders have played a formidable role in the growth and the development of Islam, in the growth and development of our community here across the continent. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and protect you and keep you strong and keep you united. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you more for your work, for your contribution, for your generosity. We come here again and again at the Islamic Society of North America with our convention only for this reason, because this is the community that has been very generous and very hospitable. My task here is to say a few words about the Islamic education, and I think this audience does not need much to be told about that, because you're already convinced and you already have seen the work of Iqra, what it has done. But it's still as a reminder to all of us, because in the zikra tanfa'ul mu'mineen, it is always good to learn more, it is good to be reminded about things that we know, because that strengthens our commitment, that strengthens our way in which we are. What do we mean by Islamic education? You know, education is to impart knowledge. And knowledge is in Arabic al-ilm, and that's why it is for education we use the word ta'lim. That means you teach, you give knowledge. And what is knowledge? Imam Ghazali, rahimahullah, said, "Al-ilmu idrakul ashiya'i kama hiya." Ilm is that you know things as they are. That is the ilm. And that is the one who knows everything as it is Allah. That's why Allah has called himself alim, Alim and Allam. Three names, they all come from Ilm. So the ultimate source of knowledge is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Alim, Al-Alim, and Al-Allam. And some ulama say that even though the word Arif is also has good meaning, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not call himself Arif. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Aqil is also a very good thing, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not call himself Aqil in the Quran. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not call himself Aqil or Arif? Because Arif is somebody who did not know and then he knew. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything always. So Ilm is the continuous, permanent way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Arif is, that's one time he did not know, now he knows. That's why this name is not used for Allah. But for human beings, yes, human beings have to learn. So, but Ilm is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. And He's the one who gave us the knowledge. عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. Some ulama say, al-ilm ma yu'assiru fi nafs. Ilm, they take the meaning of ilm from alam. And alam means sign. And they say ilm is that what put its impression upon the soul of a person. So if the knowledge does not really put its impression upon the personality, then that is really not the real knowledge. So real knowledge is that which changes the personality, which improves the person and makes the person a better person. I very much liked the word Iqra has been used beautifully, that Iqra stands for Iman, Quwwa, Rushd, and Adab. Alif for Iman, and Qaf for Quwwa, and Ra for Rushd, and Alif for Adab. Beautiful way. Actually, this is the way of knowledge in Islam, and that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word Iqra. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. That means Iman is the beginning, and Iman also gives you the quwwah of your intellect, the quwwah of your body, the quwwah of your mind, the quwwah of your soul, and the rushd. Rushd is that which brings فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ شُدَّهُ وَعَتَيْنَاهُ رُشْدًا. Rushd is the one that is the guidance, that is the strength, learning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the person. And then adab is very important. أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي. So these are the components of learning, these are the components of education, and that very beautifully identified by our brothers and sisters at Iqra. Islamic education is a gift. And this gift is in the sense because what it produces and what it's supposed to produce. Unfortunately, Islamic education has not been playing that role in the last few centuries, but otherwise Islamic education was that way, and that's why it was a great gift to the humanity. It changed the civilization, it changed the way of thinking of the people, because this is the education that brings balance between what is known as reason and revelation. Or we in Arabic terminology we say al-wahyu al-aql, or as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, al-naql wal-aql. Al-naql is whatever is transmitted, and al-aql is whatever people understand. And there is no contradiction between the two. Because the aql is very important, you should use that, but also you have to take seriously the naql that is being given to you by revelation, whether it is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the words of his prophets, especially the last prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So al-aql wa al-naql. That means the both of them should be brought together in a balance. We cannot have total reliance on our aql. But at the same time, we cannot use the naql without aql. You have to understand, requires understanding. And that's why ulama say in the fiqh we learn that, they say al-aql manat taklif. If you don't have your mind, you cannot really do the obligations properly. Those who are not aqil, they cannot fulfill the obligations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put upon them. Islamic education also is supposed to bring a balance between deen and dunya. Our religion is not only deen in the sense of that you just worship or you neglect the world, but rather you have to understand that you have obligations both ways. Yes, inna li rabbika alayka haqqan, wa inna li nafsika alayka haqqan, wa inna li zawjika alayka haqqan, wa inna li zawrika alayka haqqan, wa inna li aynika alayka haqqan. Rasulullah said that. That is, your Lord has certain rights on you, But at the same time, your body has certain rights on you. Your eyes have certain rights on you, so you have to take some rest as well. Your wife has certain rights on you, your spouse has certain rights on you, as well as your visitors have certain rights on you. So you have the rights of all the أَعْتِ كُلَّ ذِي حَقٍ حَقَّهِ. Give to everyone who has the right, give his right, he or her right to that person. So that is what deen is, deen and dunya. Neither to become totally exclusively a deen person and neglect the dunya, nor become totally immersed in the dunya and forget your deen. At the same time, Islam also emphasizes that you learn both, building a balance between this life and the other life, dunya and akhirah. وَابْتَغِ فِي مَا أَتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ وَلَا تَبْغِ الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Beautiful message, beautiful guidance, that is the balanced guidance. That is, whatever Allah has given you, seek the akhirah. But don't forget your share of this world. And do good as Allah has done good to you. And do not make corruption in the land. This is the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what knowledge is. To understand how you live in this world, and at the same time you prepare for the akhirah. And then dunya, and then the religious knowledge, Islamic knowledge is the knowledge that brings a balance between the individual and the community. Islam is not just for individuals, for fard. Islam is for jama'ah. But not jama'ah at the expense of the fard. Not fard at the expense of the jama'ah. But rather you have to have both. You have your duties, you have your responsibility towards yourself, but also you have responsibility towards your family. You have responsibility towards your community. And then Islamic education is emphasizes that you understand your role, your duties towards the Ummah. But do not forget the insaniya. It is not that just Ummah. It is not we and Muslims only. But we are living in the world of other people. And the people are of different religions, of different cultures, of different backgrounds. You have to do good to all people. You have to be nice towards all people. And that's why Rasulullah ﷺ emphasized in one of the hadith, when he was asked, who is mu'min, ya Rasulullah? Who is the true believer, ya Messenger of Allah? He said, man ya'manuhu nas ala amwalihim wa anfusihim. The believer is that whom people trust about their money and about their life. That means he's not going to hurt, he's not going to harm, he's not going to bring them a loss of their money, of their wealth, as well as of their persons. Their lives will be protected, their money will be protected. That is the true believer. And this is only if a person understands the right of all people. It is not that only we are responsible only for Muslims and we don't care about non-Muslims. We have to care for non-Muslims as well. Because they are our neighbors. We live with them. We work with them. We share this world and these resources with them. And then I was shaken by a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. It is mentioned that one day Rasulullah ﷺ came and the Sahaba were sitting. Rasulullah ﷺ stood among the people and they were all sitting. And he said, Ala unabbiukum bi khairikum min sharrikum. Fasakatu jami'an. He said, should I tell you who is good among you and who is bad among you? They were all silent. Nobody said. They were all afraid. How could they ask Rasulullah ﷺ to say that? Ala unabbiukum bi khairikum min sharrikum. Second time he said the same thing. Should I tell you who is good among you and who is bad among you? Sakatu. They did not answer. Third time he asked the question. Ala unabbiukum bi khairikum min sharrikum. Faqama rajulun. He said that. One person stood. He said, Bala ya Rasulullah. Akhbirna bi khairina and sharrina. Tell us who is good among us and who is bad among us. And the Prophet said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ يُرْجَى خَيْرُهُ وَيُؤْمَنُ شَرُّهُ وَشَرُّكُمْ مَنْ لَا يُرْجَى خَيْرُهُ وَلَا يُؤْمَنُ شَرُّهُ. The best of you are those whose good is expected from. People hope that he will bring some good to them. And people are safe from his evil. And the bad among you are those whose good is not expected, and whose shar is not safe. People are not safe from their shar. لَا يُرْجَى خَيْرُ وَلَا يُؤْمَنُ شَرُّ. Now, my brothers and sisters, we all have to ask ourselves, where do we fit in that? Do people really expect good from us and are safe from anything that will not do harm to them, will not do wrong to them? Any person will come into contact with them. So this is the criteria, and this is what the civilization, Islamic civilization, is based upon. It's a global civilization. It is not a parochial civilization. And this comes from the true knowledge of the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This comes from the right education, the right upbringing. From the very beginning, children have to be raised upon that. You cannot teach them later. Some people can be taught later. But this is the knowledge that is based on the true nature of the human being, the fitrah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created human being. Fatara fitratallahi allati fatara an-nasa alayha. So enhance the fitrah, improve the fitrah, fulfill the fitrah. That is the education. That is the purpose of education. And this brings the personalities. That the gift of Islamic education is the real mu'min. The real mu'min, the real servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the gift of Islamic education. That is the people who go through this whole process of learning, they see all these books, then they come out as balanced people, as integrated people, as organized people, as good people. And these are the people who give good to the humanity. Allah Rasulullah, if you really read ahadith of the Prophet and you see what kind of a person Rasulullah wanted the human being, a believer should be. What kind of a person the Rasulullah wanted a Muslim should be. There's so many beautiful examples that he gave. Muscle after muscle that he used to give about the believers. In one of the hadith, he said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بَيَدِهِ. By him in whose hand is Muhammad's soul. مَسَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ كَمَسَلِ النَّحْلَةِ أَكَلَ الطَّيِّبًا وَوَضَعَ الطَّيِّبًا. Rasulullah said, by him in whose hand is Muhammad's soul, the example of a believer is like a honey bee. It consumes good and produces good. That's the way the believer should be, like a honey bee. And further he said, وَلَمْ تَكْسُرْ وَلَمْ تُفْسِدْ. لَمْ تَكْسُرْ وَلَمْ تُفْسِدْ. The honey bee sits on the flower, it does not spoil the flower. It takes whatever it wants to take from the flower, it doesn't spoil the flower. The flower is intact, does not break it, does not spoil it. He said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ مَسَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ كَمَسَلِ النَّحْلَةِ. In another hadith, the Prophet said, he said, the believer is like a nakhla, like a dead palm. لَا تَسْقُطُ وَرَقُهَا وَهِيَ مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ وَمَثَلُ الْمُسْلِمِ. And there is the Prophet ﷺ, one day he asked the question, Sahaba were sitting and he asked them, he said, do you know who is the, إِنَّ مِنَ الشَّجَرِ شَجَرَةً لَا يَسْقُطُ وَرَقُهَا وَهِيَ مَثَلُ الْمُسْلِمِ. Among the trees, there is a tree whose leaves don't drop, and it is like a Muslim. And many Sahaba, they started thinking about what that tree would be. People started thinking about all different kind of trees in the desert. Abdullah ibn Umar was a young boy at that time. He was sitting there, and he said, "Waqa fi nafsi anna nakhla. I thought it is the palm dead palm." But he was shy. فَلَفَاسْتَحَيْتْ. I was shy. I did not say that. Then they say, Ya Rasulullah, أَخْبِرْنَا مَا هِيَ. Ya Rasulullah, tell us which one, what it is. And he said, هِيَ النَّخْلَة. It is the date palm. Why date palm? Because it's benefit. Very beneficial. It takes little but gives more. Always beneficial. So that's what Rasulullah wanted the human being, a Muslim should be. In another hadith, the Rasulullah said, مَسَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ كَمَسَلَ قِطْعَةٍ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ. The example of a believer is like a piece of gold. كَمَسَلَ قِطْعَةٍ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ. يَنْفَقُ عَلَيْهَا صَاحِبُهَا فَلَا يَنْقُصْ وَلَا يَفْسُدْ. He said, it goes to the fire and it does not burn. Actually, it comes out better and pure. That's the way the Muslim should be. In another hadith, he says, مَسَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ كَمَسَلِ السُّنْبُلَةِ. The example of a mu'min, of a believer, is like a sumbula. Sumbula is the corn plant, which is full of grain. And he said, the winds come, they will not break it. It goes this side, it goes this side, to stand up again. The Muslim goes through difficulties, challenges, but Muslim does not break. Muslim stand up. Muslim is the one who stand up. And this is because of the personality that we develop. This is the gift of Islam. This is the gift of Islamic education. This is the gift of Islamic knowledge. The Prophet ﷺ said, in another hadith, he said, مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِ لِلْمُؤْمِنِ كَالْبُنِيَانِ يَشُدُّ بَعْضُهُ بَعْضًا. The true believer is for another believer is like a building. Every brick is supporting the other brick. They support each other. مَثَلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فِي تَوَادِّهِمْ كَتَرَاحِمِهِمْ كَمَثَلِ الْجَسَدِ الْوَاحِدِ. The believers in their mutual love, in their mutual support, they are like one body. If part of the body has pain, the whole body has pain. This is the gift of Islam. That is the kind of community, that community that is supposed to be raised. So this is what we are talking about. We are not talking about only building buildings. Because buildings can be there, and buildings do not keep the people. When I visited Spain, I visited Alhambra Palace. Wallahi, you go to each room and you see there so many tughras, so many beautiful inscriptions. La ghaliba illallah, la ghaliba illallah, everywhere. It's written there. If those tughras could save the people, they would have saved them. But none of them saved them. The katbas and all these inscriptions, they don't save the people. The buildings do not save the people. What saves the people is the personality, the character. The people are the one. If the people become corrupt, building cannot save them. People have to be right people. People have to live. And this comes with the true knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This comes from the Quran. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. خلق الإنسان من علق. اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم. علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. And you read the Quran, you will find that in many places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions His rahmah. And whenever He gives the command to the people, He mentions His karam, His rahmah. Always, there are more than 200 ayat of the Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned His command with rahmah. Rahim, Ra'uf al-Rahim. And that's why ulama say, Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said very nicely, he said that Ash-Shari'atu rahmatun kulluha, hikmatun kulluha, adlun kulluha, maslahatun kulluha. وكل مسألة خرجت من الحكمة إلى العبس ومن الرحمة إلى ضدها ومن العدل إلى الجور ومن المصلحة إلى المفسدة وليست من دين الدين من الشريعة ولو أدخلت فيها بالتأويل. He said that our religion is nothing except rahmah. Allah mercy. Our religion is nothing except hikmah, wisdom. Our religion is nothing except justice and fair dealing. Our religion is nothing except the benefit of the people, maslahatun nas. If you find anything in our religion that has no hikmah, that is just waste of time, hikmah, abas. If you find anything in our religion that has no rahmah, that has no mercy, if you find anything in our religion that is jawr, zulm, not adl, if you find anything in our religion that is mafsada, not maslaha, فَلَيْسَتْ مِنَ الدِّينِ. It's not from the deen. Even though people may say by their interpretation it is deen, it is not deen. Understand that. Ibn Qayyim rahmahullah, he says this in what book? إعلام الموقعين. The book in which he mentions about how to give fatwa, how to interpret the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the very beginning he said that this is the way you give fatwa to the people. Understand the rahmah, understand the hikmah, understand the adl, understand the maslaha of the people. This is the way you understand the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how this is going to come? This is going to come from good literature, good writing, good books. So book play a very important role. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent His book. He sent the book and He sent the messenger. a book, a curriculum, and teachers. And then, of course, the people are changed. So the work that is going on here with Iqra, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless, is a lot of endowment, a lot of contribution. But all this work is going on through producing books, selling books. There is nothing special, no special fund for research, no special fund for revision. Because you put all of that, the book price will be too much, and people will not buy them, they'll have difficulty. So you have to keep the prices low, you have to have the best qualities, and you have to, at the same time, you have to have good research, and you have to do continuously all this work. How is all this going to be done? It cannot be done by a few people, it cannot be done by just meager resources, it requires a lot of resources. So Jazakum Allahu Khairan for those of you who contributed generously, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you and bless you. And also, as was mentioned before, please think about it, that how you can make this part of your monthly budget. Even a small amount, $10, $50, $100, whatever you can. Now you can live Allah nafsan illa wasaha. Put this part of your budget, because it's easy then after that. If you give $1,200 at the end of the year, it will be difficult. But if you give like $100 a month, it's easy. $50 a month, easy. It goes like that. That's something else. And if you go to the shopping, people put all kind of things here and there in the carriage and then go. I checked out. Nobody thinks about, oh, $20 going away, $50 going away. Just putting things like that. This is the way how we spend money. But when it comes to giving for those that are constructive things, sometimes people start, shaitan start coming, oh, you don't have money, you don't have this, you don't have that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses those who think about that way. Subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses those who think our work, who think our purpose, who think what it is going to bring about. So it is going to bring a change, inshallah. A new generation is going to come. And this generation will be the real citizens of the United States, of the world, who will care for everyone. They will not care only for themselves, for their families, for their community, for their country, but they will care for the whole world. And that will come from the real understanding of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah's message. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless thee the first. Jazakum Allahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you.